tough times are a great reminder of business basics which need to be set right. For India's real estate sector, now is the time to refocus on one big issue which plagues the industry. Even after decades of trying to change its image, the lack of transparency is one big issue. Studies done globally and back home show a direct correlation between foreign fund flows and transparency in business practices. So for an industry which is now witnessing a rapid drop in FDI and a cash crunch, there isn't a better time to focus on what are the gaps still and how can they be fixed. Welcome everyone to a Realty Debate on Mission Transparency in Real Estate. An agenda defined by CREDAI, the leading industry body, and we'll carry it forward in this discussion. Let me introduce my panelists, starting with Sushil Mantri, Chairman and Managing Director, Mantri Developers. Chirag Ramakrishnan, Chief Executive Officer, Equinox Realty. Anshul Jain, Chief Executive Officer, DTZ India. Sachin Sandeep, Managing Director and Country Head, India RICS. And Sameer Jasuja, Founder and CEO of Prop Equity. Gentlemen, thanks very much for joining in here on this very interesting discussion. I'm going to set the stage a little bit with this graphic and some pointers. Now, Jones Lang LaSalle, Indian Real Estate Transparency Index 2011, if you look at that report, says that property markets in developing nations like India are largely inefficient compared in developed nations, primarily due to the dismal levels of transparency in the real estate ecosystem. The prime reasons, they say, are lack of information, corruption, multiplicity or ambiguity in taxation and lengthy procedures. Let's first establish that things have improved a whole lot in India. India, which had been ranking amongst the lowest on the transparency parameter in Asia, and we're talking only real estate here, is also the country which has seen the maximum improvement in it. But let me start with my panelists' thoughts. Mr. Mantri, I'm going to come to you first. What has been achieved? Yes, something has been achieved, but is it too little so far?
See, when we talk about the transparency, I put it into two sections. First, I would say that the at the government level approvals and so many other issues. And other one, I will put it at a firm developer side responsibilities. In last 15 to 20 years, if we really see, at a government level, I think very little has been achieved. And rather than achieving a better transparency, I think we have deteriorated on that area. But if we see on a developer front, if you observe last 15 to 20 years, I think our country has achieved quite a lot. Because I recollect 20 years before, buying a car was Fiat and Ambassador. But only options were color. Now today, we have a huge choice. The same thing has happened in the developers. And each developer while selling a product gives a huge specifications list, give all the terms and conditions of the transaction. And all these things shows that he tried to achieve better and better and trying to give more and more information to the customer. So that when really the delivery take place, customer get what has been promised to him or her. And this on a transparency index, if we really see what are the contractual commitment, offering commitments are given by the developer, fairly they have reached to a very good level of achievement and they are fairly doing a good job. But at a government level, I think we are, rather than improving, we have gone down on these areas. Rather than building the transparency, I think the more and more hurdles has been created, more and more secrecies has been created, and I think our country, instead of progressing, has gone maybe two notches down. This is what my views about the transparency.
All right, Chirag, you know, the prime reason which Mr. Mantri thinks is the government lack of transparency on government dealings, which is still the biggest reason for probably driving the industry down, but that's from the industry's perspective as a whole. I mean, let's even focus on the JLL report. The four things: lack of information, which could be developer driven, which could be government driven, corruption, which could happen mostly at government local bodies front, multiplicity or ambiguity in taxation, now again a government issue, lengthy procedures, again a government issue. So really, are we saying the three out of four big issues for the industry being perceived as non-transparent is not in the hands of the industry per se? That I think would be too simplistic, isn't it?
But as developers, we are a very simple class of people, right? on a more serious note, it is a fact that this is not Singapore, where all the approvals that we require to get is clearly put on site, and I can tell you what is going to happen next. Tax regime is stable. We know exactly what's going to happen in the next 2, 3, 4, 5 years. One day we have ST, next day we have VAT, third day the ST thing gets changed, and it keeps going on. So how do you commit to a buyer what his final cost of apartment will be? So who comes across looking as not transparent? Us. Similarly, if you look at the approval process, I mean, if you look at in Singapore, you'll see very clearly that there is a very clear date of delivery that is expected by the government from the developer. Up here, the developer is screaming to the government, please tell me when I'm going to get my approval, leave aside delivery. So, you know, the number of hurdles, Sushilji is absolutely right, have just gone up. The ambiguity in the hurdles has gone up manifold. That is the larger challenge for us. You don't know whether all the approvals you've got is enough, or will you be getting more? Will you require something during the progress? So how can I commit to my buyer anything beyond telling him that I will commit to you the specs I have written in the contract? The timelines, I'm hoping that I will achieve it. You know, it's really something that in a large way is going back to what I was saying, very rightly so, that give us a single window from which we can very clearly understand what is expected from us, and therefore we know what to commit to the consumer. We have gone ahead, I put up CRMs, we have put in place, you know, we have even put in place connectivity through technology for them to see real time how the progress is going. Beyond that, what can we do? I don't know.
Okay, so interesting here, then, you know, the fingers getting pointed to the government. I mean, I think the source of all issues, all problems in the industry seem to be one, which is delays in government approvals, not having a fix on what's going to happen, when will it come, and therefore one is a developer cannot really commit to a timeline, but they do, Anshul. That's the problem. They do. If they didn't have a fix on it, why do they go and commit on it?
It's a issue around sales, right? If somebody sells you a flat and says, I'm going to deliver it, when, I don't know, will you buy? You will not, right? I empathize with what Chirag and Mr. Mantri has been saying, and I think they've hit the nail right on the head from a government point of view. But I think from a development industry perspective as well, not as much has been done which one could look at. Now, for example, there's been enough instances where money's been collected from the buyers but used to buy land. Yeah. I mean, it's a pretty much a well-known fact. And therefore, if the money has been diverted and suddenly the economy changes and the money cycle dries up or the cash flow dries up or the bank stops lending money or reduces its lending, how are you going to finish the development? Hmm. We talk about transparency from a delivery perspective, putting in specs within the brochures, etc. Fantastic. And you know, any development that you buy, any flat that you buy, comes with a very fancy brochure with all the specs laid out. What is the recourse I as a consumer have it if you don't deliver? You know, and those are the issues which consumers are facing with, which I think the development sector as a whole, and I think CREDAI has achieved quite a lot, but I think there's still a lot that they can do to at least try and self-govern and improve their image in the industry, regardless of what's happening, regardless of the bottlenecks which are being created by the government.
By the government. And there's many a slip between the cup and the lip, even though this key survey finding of JLL Transparency Index says it was conducted among developers and majority of the developers said they wanted to or intended to increase transparency in the real estate sector. Overwhelming 97% of the respondents expressed their intent to provide actual measurements for calculating saleable area and carpet area, which is the biggest concern for the consumer. 93% of the developers expressed their intent to quote rates that are all inclusive of other charges such as parking, clubhouse and maintenance, etc. I have yet to see a project which is sold such in India right now. But most of the developers were not very keen to disclose sources of funding and shareholding pattern. I'm going to come to the third one later, but the first two are very important, Sachin. So developers, if you talk to them, if in a survey, and this was done with CREDAI and JLL together, by those two together, their intent is there, but even now that intent isn't being followed through. I mean, yes, there are certain set of developers who are doing it, but it's a rare breed.
I think absolutely valid, Manisha. So really, you know, if you really look at it, you talked about measurement, and you know, I mean, I'd like to kind of go back to the entire life cycle really of a real estate transaction. You know, you start with land. You know, let's just look at it in terms of land. I mean, the first starting point of where we kind of tend to go wrong is valuation, and you know, the independence and the objectivity of the valuation. Then you really look at the process in terms of the sales process, you know, to the consumer. Now, and that's really where, obviously, you know, like I said, Creda has done a fantastic job in terms of getting some element of professionalism. The point on the approval processes needing to be streamlined, that's understood. But really look at it. I think Anshul touched some of those points there. Really, when you talk about measurement internationally, you know, you have standard codes for measurement. You know, what is gross and what is net is very, very clearly understood. And you know, we may say that we sell on, whether it's gross or net is, you know exactly what you're going to get. And typically the basis of all transactions that happen is net. Here, the enforcement of, you know, one, there is the absence of such a code, obviously. So, you know, internationally, whether it's BOMA or the RICS code, these are popular codes that are followed across in different markets. You know, going further, you know, we talked about, Anshul again touched on an important aspect. You know, we know that it takes time to kind of get approvals. We know that it takes 2.5 years. So, you know, while a minuscule percentage of the developers will be saying that fair enough, we'll deliver in 3 years or 4 years, but the fact of the matter is we're not factoring in those 2.5 years into the overall picture.
We are overselling, yes, and under delivering. That's the problem. I think despite being aware of the realities, if I launch a project and say I will not deliver in 3 years, people will not buy it, because there is another guy who will probably say he will deliver in 2 years. So who's going to be the first one to say, look, I will not be able to deliver in 5 years. It will take me 5 years to put this project on ground.
So that's obviously not happening. So, you know, that's really where the other aspect of it that, you know, when you're looking at it again from the customer's perspective, really in terms of the contract, you know, and, you know, the fact of the matter is contracts are very, very one-sided. And really from the consumer, if you were to look at it and you were trying to, fair enough, there is a, you know, there are all the issues that the developers face in terms of you know, approvals and stuff, but the fact of the matter is, you know, if you were to try and
contract isn't honored, it isn't honored. So Sameer, come in here and tell me, is it because it's so easy to get away if you don't honor a contract, isn't it? It's as simple as that. There's really no recourse that a consumer has.
No, and that's absolutely true, because if you go to the courts, it takes 5 to 7 years to get a judgment. And if the consumer was to go to court, he doesn't even get possession of his house. So he is actually living on rent, or he's probably living in his own property. But irrespective of that, he's paid 90 to 95% of the property value. He doesn't have the property in his hand. Where is he going to have the wherewithal to go to courts and fight? And so on and so forth to try and get possession of the property. The second thing that I don't completely agree with, one thing with respect to transparency, and I don't blame the government entirely and this approval process entirely. First of all, you cannot sell the project before you don't have some approvals, right? After that, you have construction related approvals. I don't know of a single developer who waits for those approvals. He goes out and starts his construction, and those approvals come in time as they come. Really speaking, I think the delays that have happened with respect to all developments have been with respect to transferring the cash flow of the project into another project. Also, the developer does not start construction till he has not sold 50 to 60% of the project.
Absolutely. Because he only starts constructing with the consumer's money.
No, but more importantly, if he sold 20% of the project and the project does not sell and he starts construction before that, even if he's got money from private equity, he will be stuck very badly. So really speaking, the developer actually goes out and sells 60% of the project and then thinks of starting construction. That is why the delays actually happen, because till he does not sell that 60%, and that takes about 18 months typically for the developer to go out and sell it.
Right.
And then he is left with only 18 months to complete the project.
Mr. Mantri, how would you react to that? We absolutely understand and agree that there's lot which has happened on the transparency front, but you know, just the basic norms and ethical practices which developers need to follow, why are only very few developers following it? Why hasn't it become a more widely accepted and spread out norm?
See, what happened, this real estate business is a quite local, because all the local rules regulations are applicable to the development. Each and every city has their own rules regulations. So and after understanding all these problem, CREDAI came out with a definition of carpet area and the built up area, and that has been displayed on the CREDAI website, as well as each and every member of the CREDAI has to sign a code of conduct, which they have already done it, and those members who have not signed the code of conduct, they are expected to get terminated from the CREDAI. That is the resolution has been passed in the CREDAI. So this will solve the bring the uniformity across the India for area of calculation, like what is carpet area, what is built up area, and at what developer is supposed to sell. Only the rates will keep fluctuating as per the each and every member. Because of not having a standard.
What about the big problem, Mr. Mantri? The fact that developers actually launch a project even without getting their approvals in place. That's the big concern that I wanted you to comment on.
Yeah, but actually speaking, if you really see the as per the code of conduct, it is not allowed to launch the project before the all the approvals are received. Now few developers are launching, but if you really see the about 40% members are only 40% developers are only the CREDAI members. There is no control CREDAI can have on the non-CREDAI members, and that is where the real problem is happening. Because of maybe 5 to 10% developers, the entire community, entire fraternity get name get damaged. Otherwise, if you see any reputed developer, nobody is launching the project.
It's a vicious circle as well, Manisha. I think the issue is how do you finance your development? So once you've sort of purchased the land, usually you haven't paid the land prices in full, right? You applied for your licenses, you can't get your private equity investment in unless the land's kind of converted and ready to go, right? The private equity will not sort of put money in. So where do you actually find money to get the construction going? So unless you are able to sell 20-25% of the project, it's very difficult at times for developers to actually start garnering funds.
So it's a very chicken and an egg situation. But let's come to this very important point. Most developers were not very keen to disclose sources of funding and shareholding pattern. Chirag Ramakrishnan, why is that? I mean, this is the biggest opacity in the entire real estate sector, isn't it? Starting from there, in terms of where is the money coming from, how is it getting accounted, leave aside the top 20 developers or even 40 developers of the country. This industry actually has 8,000 developers.
Manisha, like Sushilji said, it's a very localized business. So sources of money is very difficult to trace beyond the top 20-30 builders. And it's going back to exactly what he's saying on even the transparency in terms of launching without approvals. We are unable to control the few bad wolves in the pack who are launching projects, even though we very clearly said we should launch only after a certain period of time. Similarly, when it comes to money flows, now this industry has been blackballed in the past for being a haven for all kinds of money, and that continues to happen. Again, I would not like to take the examples of a few and put it across the entire industry. You should look at the guys who are giving you very clear. It's an industry in transformation, and I think one should give it its due course to clean it up by over a period of time. It will be very difficult for us to attempt this overnight.
All right, fair enough. And CREDAI has done a wonderful job, frankly. I mean, even the mission transparency to take it on, as Sushil said, that, you know, the members do not encompass the entire universe of developers. So what do you need? You really need a regulator, you need an authoritative voice, because after all, CREDAI doesn't have any punitive actions or punitive powers. So can the opacity in the sector be blamed on the absence of any regulator? If yes, why can't our government get the regulator bill through? Will it come in this monsoon session? That's up next. State regulator bill, if passed, increase the transparency and accountability in the industry? Well, let's look at some key highlights of the bill first. The bill aims to establish a regulatory authority and an appellate tribunal. It will set up an industry watchdog, and all properties being developed on land parcels with areas greater than 4,000 square meter shall be registered with the regulatory authority. There's also a provision for penalty for developers. Under the proposed law, developers will have to submit project details like approved layout plans, timeline, cost, sale agreement to the regulator before launching projects. Now, failure to do so will entail a penalty of 10% of the project cost on the developers or jail of a maximum of 3 years. In extreme cases, they could even lose their license. But the question is, how radically can this change the face of Indian real estate when it has many, many more inherent flaws? Chirag, your comments first. Regulator bill, do you want a regulator or you think it's not really needed at all? At least at the national level, should the bill be passed in the session?
You know, my concern with the national regulator is it going to open another window? We already have some 40 windows to clear. I have a dirty feeling that this is just going to be one more window. So don't get me wrong, I'm not worried about 3 year jail and all the fines that they're thinking of doing. But I'm just saying that every state is a country by itself. We do better with state level regulators who are allowing us to get single window clearances. So with authority should come power as well. If you're going to tell me there's authority and no power to get all my approvals, then I'm back to square one with just one more window. So what have we achieved? I think we'll just delay the process by another 6 months and slow the industry down even further. That's my...
Do you believe that too? I mean, Chirag is a very valid point there. He's saying, why? You're just creating another authority and another 6 month delay for me.
He's absolutely right. I mean, the way the bill is positioned at this point in time, it's doomed to fail. It will just not succeed. You are basically going to add one further regulation into an already heavily over-regulated industry. Hmm. If you've got to go
or
and
badly
get
regulated, over-regulated.
Exactly. Right. Because the thing is, when you have 40 different regulators looking at various aspects of real estate development, to be honest, that breeds corruption. So you are actually dealing with 40 different authorities which the government itself has the inability to control corruption in. Now, if you have some structural reforms in the regulations that's required, put that under a single window system like a SEBI, for example, you can control the body a lot better, and the body in effect can control the whole real estate development
this
across the country better.
It's state level subject.
So that I think needs to change, because at the end of the day, look at what SEBI does, right? It has a legislative role, it has a governance role. So by legislative, it makes policies. By governance, it executes and ensures that everybody is doing their job properly. And lastly, it has a judicial role as well, where it runs tribunals and passes judgments, which can only be challenged in Supreme Court,
right?
And nowhere else, right? So those judgments are really powerful. As a consumer, I feel cheated. I know where to go to, who are time bound to give me that judgment, which can only be challenged in the Supreme Court and nowhere else, right? But what happens is, if one body is driving this across the country, then there is a uniformly accepted rules which don't confuse people. Also, then what will happen is, at each state level, it will increase competition, because a developer from north can go to south and start business much more easily, and so on and so forth. Hmm. So you see a lot more healthy competition, because everybody suddenly starts to understand the regulation. Why limit it to state? Which means what's going to happen is that the state level transparency will only remain within the state, and if someone else is coming in, he still has to think through different regulations in different states.
Different issues, yes. And Maharashtra has been the first state government to pass the regulator bill. So, Mr. Mantri, you tell me, what's been the experience? I mean, is that something that's worrying you, that a national level regulator will just add to the task and the entire bill only focuses on the developers, not on making it easier on the government front, not on tackling corruption at the local authority or local body level at all?
See, this industry is already having 54 acts and rules applicable to us, and we have to pass through 224 tables to get any building permit approved. Now, in such a highly over-regulated industry, by adding one more regulator, what happens? Let's look for the reasons of delay in the project, why happened. Today, we are governed under several acts, and each officer at each table harass the developers and for giving their approvals or NOC. These are the legitimate right of any building. These approvals are delayed unnecessarily for the best known reasons to the respective people. What is the need of so many regulations? Now, if you see, the government recognize the advocate and any lawyer certificate government recognize. The same way the chartered accountant certificate is recognized by the government, doctor certificate is recognized by the government. why architect certificate is not recognized by the government and the building is allowed to start the project? Because today the delays are between 1 year to 3 years in a city like a Bangalore, and I am sure all over the India the similar situation is there. This is loading the interest cost, and the corruption gets commenced because it is over-regulated. Now coming a national level body, now already we are facing the state level, city level and national level rules and regulations. By adding one more, if we are expecting everything will change dramatically, we absolutely feel it is not going to happen. And one more regulation will add, corruption will further increase. And today the apartment prices, which are already increased because of these delays, because of the interest cost, it will further go up. I don't think anything is going to be achieved out of this. Rather, government should think of making more and more simplification in the process of approval, and they should put more responsibilities on the architect who are coming from a recognized Architect Association of India institution, and put more responsibilities on people like CREDAI, who if something wrong happens, they will terminate the such members. And I think, and give a wide publicity for such termination, as well as if somebody does wrong, I think the government should come forward and demolish such building. If one or two such instances happen, I am assuring you the entire India will become much superior, and at least 90% plus people or developer will become more responsible and start following the rules and regulations.
Sameer, would you agree with that, or you still think that a regulator is definitely needed? Maybe not in the current form that the bill provisions for. You need to give it a lot more thought on how would you actually make it pro-consumer.
I strongly think a regulator is needed, definitely from a consumer point of view. What I can't understand is that why do you need to create another layer of approvals through the regulator? You can just submit information to them, let them validate the information that they've received from the developer against the consumer complaint and take a decision. There doesn't have to be another step in this whole process that takes more time.
Well, they have to register. Even if you're going to develop more than 4,000 square feet,
you just register. How much time does it take to register? As it is, you're filing all those forms with other 40
agencies.
So it doesn't really matter.
But to help, I mean, unless we have a common set of policies which the regulator is able to publish, right? What's the registration going to do, right? So I mean, if
you have all the information, the regulator has all the information with respect to super to carpet area.
So those rules need to be first set up.
The question is, how do you measure super area and carpet area?
Absolutely.
So my contention is that the regulator must first come up with a set of policies.
Absolutely.
Right, which is the legislative role, and it should say this is how property should be measured in India, right? This is the normal timeline which it should take for developer to do, and these are the normal timelines which the government should be able to give its license in. So the regulator should be designed in a way that if the consumer says my apartment's been delayed, the regulator should be able to pinpoint as to where the delay has been, whether from the developer side or the government licensing side.
Unfortunate part is we all know how to measure super to carpet area. Every architect knows how to measure. It's not that ambiguous.
No, but what is super area?
Absolutely.
No, but they can be added on to the...
Yeah, what is super area? Sameer, is a moot point.
Well,
what
we had a whole debate on super to carpet area.
So here they fundamentally
actually uncovered what actually super area is and carpet area.
So you know, there are two points.
So here is the consensus that we do need a regulator for the consumers. I think I would be on Sameer's side here, because we deal with questions coming in every day, and we can see the kind of pain points that a consumer faces sitting on a loan. You know, sometimes it gets as bad, Chirag, as the developer, and I'm talking about some of the largest developers of the country. These are not small developers, not non-members of CREDAI, but the listed big developers who refuse to even acknowledge the fact that their projects are getting delayed. We've all seen those reports. So somewhere there has to be somebody who's on the side of the consumer and pulling the developers up. CREDAI does not have the punitive powers at all, isn't it?
So I'm saying that it's not that we don't want to have a regulator. I am saying in its current form, what they are proposing is not viable. What Sameer is talking is blue sky. We need to figure out a tribunal, or we need to figure out a body or a forum that can address consumer complaints. But that body without empowerment is of no use. Having a body that is empowered but cannot license is again of no use. Having a central body that is licensing across 15 states without knowing all the various approval processes in those 15 states, I mean, you're trying to kill a huge layer of bureaucracy. This will never get cleared.
So you need to take baby steps. And my suggestion is just think baby steps first. I think we are asking for the moon at the regulator level, which means there is no intent to do it.
So if we can do two things, you know, I mean, the starting point really is, you know, that we're talking about two separate things. One is consumer redress. We need a regulator. That's the point. That's there. We need a redress mechanism. You know,
I don't think we need a regulator. What we need is a redressal mechanism, a powerful one for the consumer.
Yeah. And the second bit is that we're talking about is how can we streamline building approvals and reduce red tapeism. And for that, the answer is to try and outsource it, you know, and to let that part be handled by professional bodies. So, you know, that will simplify and fast track in, and
will it ever happen in this country? Mr. Mantri, come in here. Will it ever happen in this country? I mean, you've been dealing with the government. You said at the start of this discussion that it's becoming worse for developers such as you to deal with government and local bodies. So, what are you expecting going forward?
No, I think it can happen in our great country, India. If you see the Bihar, they have taken the architect certificate and you can commence the construction work. And within 90 days, the government has an accountability to give the approvals in the due course. But the work basically commences immediately. And today, in our state like Bihar, it can happen. Why the same model cannot be applied in entire India? So that the interest cost comes down and those people who do the illegal, that becomes the first and last project for them, and government can always demolish that building. Another thing which we are talking about, the consumer interest. Now, so many government authorities have done this apartment construction in all over the India. You take the CIDCO, you take DDA, you take BDA, and so many authorities. Why not a single government authority customers are satisfied? Where the 100% transparency was maintained, everything has happened. No, not a single government project got completed on time. The construction quality is the most lousy, which where nobody would like to stay. So I think the issue is when developers are providing a quality construction. And why we don't recognize that when government has totally failed, why we don't try to make a simplification? If the simplification comes, competition will increase and that will take care of a lot of things, which I think nobody is looking from that angle.
Right. Point taken. So I'm going to conclude this session. You know, something is on the top of each panelist. Mind, what should you do to increase transparency in the real estate sector? Chirag, let's start with you. Give me a one-point agenda. Let's not go to three or four things. We know we need to set many things right, but what is the first thing you'd like to change in the industry and in the country?
I'll just take one step back before I say what I want. I'm saying from the consumer side, 60-70% of all the developers who are recognized have done more than what they should be doing. They've already started sharing everything they know, everything they can possibly know, from carpet areas to super areas. They are declaring their amenities. Are they providing it eventually or no is debatable, but they are providing information. They have CRM modules in place. They are carrying out proper communication in terms of progress. What I would love to see is a single window clearance. Is there a way in which I can definitely say how long it will take for me to kickstart my project? How long will it take for me to get all my approvals even after I have started my project, in the last few pieces of approvals, if at all there is requirement for those? And most important, are all the approvals ring-fenced? Can I just get that one piece back from the government?
Right. Top on your wish list, Anshul. Single window clearance?
Single window clearance with the teeth. Right, so you come to me, I'll kill all the corruption associated with 40-50 different licenses that you got to take. I'll give you everything, but if you don't deliver, I'll come after you with punitive action.
All right, that's a very interesting point. If with this single window clearance. The ambitious 6-lane expressway between NCR and Agra has opened finally. The project is definitely an infrastructure achievement in a country where projects take decades and more to see the light of day. The quality of construction to the security systems all are at par with the best internationally. This infra project, though, is also a huge real estate play for the JP Group and those living in the National Capital Region. In my conversation with Manoj Kaur, I started by asking him what was the biggest challenge in getting the project through.
I am grateful to God that I represent an organization which is led by a very visionary and courageous leader, Shri Jay Prakash Ji, who has a habit of taking challenges and implementing them with great passion. He's a dreamer. UP government thought for a project like this way back in year 2000. And Jay Prakash Ji took that call. Challenges have been land acquisition. Challenges have been how leadership viewed every time the project. All these years, we all know what happened in different part of the country. Land acquisition has been a big issue all over, but that also meant additional impact on the land acquisition price. Courageous leadership of Jay Prakash Ji ensured that there were no difference of opinion in what government was changing and what we were willing to accept. We accepted every decision of government of UP, not because there is a gold mine in this, because we wanted to complete the project.
So you're saying working in collaboration with the government has
stood you? In collaboration and accepting those price overruns which have come at a cost. And ultimately, I can only today confirm that land acquisition price went up from 800 crore and NSI 2003 to 2900 crores. We have absorbed it.
Let's come to the real estate play, because this is way beyond an infra story. It's a real estate play. Tell us, how much of the land value do you hope to unlock? There's already some parcels which have, the development has started, but give us a vision of the real estate around Yamuna Expressway. Noida, Greater Noida is probably now most projects have got launched, Manoj Bhai, if I'm not mistaken.
Manisha Ji, the point is that in 5 land parcels, we have opportunity to do about 450 million square feet. We have launched total about 40 million. So about 10%. Now, that is when I say 40 million we did, but now expressway ready, second stream starts. Now we can slightly concentrate on quality. I have to say, and I think you know very well, our real estate, which is part of JP Infratech, is the only real estate in the country which provides opportunity to offer an integrated city. There are different products, including villas, townhomes, lower income group, medium income group, high income group. Everyone wants to be close to school, to the mall, to the cinema hall, to the women college, all. And Vistown Noida is the model we are going to replicate at each of the location.
There's a long way to go in monetization of the entire land bank, but give me a vision for the next 5 years, because what you mentioned on the expressway itself, that the revenues through the traffic and the toll, you will actually start seeing any kind of big traction only after 2017, which is about 5 years from now. So for the next 5 years, what's coming from real estate?
We expect from real estate, as I mentioned to you, we are not going to be in a hurry. Ultimately, we have sold already 40 million, which was perhaps
about 18,000 units or more?
25,000. Including Sports City.
Okay, if you.
This is quite a bit. And so now, intention is to sell about 2 crore square feet every year. And complete and hand over. There is another very important concept which we have worked, because you asked me to be very specific over the next 5 years. The parcel number 2 and parcel number 3 and the sports city where Formula 1 happened, all we have connected by a 16 kilometer boulevard. And that boulevard is actually minimum 60 meter wide and maximum 200 meter wide. and there, and what is the boulevard? It is actually going to give that clear connectivity to these three parcels, which are 5,000 acres. And this boulevard is passing under the Yamuna Expressway. So, next 5 years, because I am sure you have the benefit of having all the footages, NDTV especially, because they are the one who saw
the beginning of the expressway.
Yes, and yes. I have to say and compliment you and your colleagues who believed that JP would do this project. As an organization, I am all for a sensible, respectable solution for land acquisition where every party is happy. The moment the expressway are made, road are made, the land adjoining to the road, they become valuable.
Absolutely.
So it is not that JP is getting benefit or A is getting benefit, it is everyone getting benefit. And I must say that you are going to see a sea change in next 5 years, the type of development which are going to happen on this road. If you just go back in time, 10 years back, nobody was even talking about the potential which Noida, Greater Noida had for real estate. Nobody had any imagination. And we believe, with the expressway now in operation, this cascading impact will reach up to Agra. Agra may not fetch the same rate, but ultimately Agra will see a lot of activity.
So I have a counter question to Greater Noida, Noida. Infrastructure is absolutely probably the best in NCR, way better than Gurgaon, and yet if you look at the property rates of this area, they are way lower than Gurgaon, and that's simply, Manoj Bhai, because UP is not being able to attract business. UP is not being able to attract commerce. If job creation doesn't happen, there's only that much of an extra kicker you will get from having great infrastructure. You're building integrated townships, but there should be people who will come and take office space there, isn't it? Is that something that worries you?
I would be wrong if I say it doesn't worry me. Of course, it is a question which you are very right. But I am seeing, some sequence which is very uncanny. First, road is not made. First, cars are made. Mobiles are made. When those additional roads get choked, then people think of roads, new roads, flyovers, expressway. It looks like a chicken and egg story. We are making the real estate, is not new city will come. Infrastructure is superb. Now, UP government, I am sure, would take cognizance how industry should be encouraged. I have great hope that opening of Yamuna Expressway, Shri Akhilesh Yadav ji has sent a very positive signal that this state would do anything to encourage investment, and 12,000 crore investment seeing light of day in UP after his party came back to power and he is in the driver's seat. So this is a big symbol. At the same time, unfortunate incident at Gurgaon on Maruti, people are going to think to 10 times to make a new investment in Haryana. This is an opportunity for UP.
Give us some comfort on the delivery. You know, there's so much which has been launched in real estate from the JP Group. And to be absolutely upfront, most of our viewers, because I do a real estate show and we recommend some of the properties very avidly because they come up in our research database. Dealing with the group, the customer service, etc., experience has been very good so far. But in terms of, if I look at the numbers, 25,000 units launched and the numbers delivered finally are a very small percentage of it. Give us that sense of comfort that in terms of execution and delivery, the group is absolutely on the top of it, because I mean there are lots of forces which are making this business also not a very easy business.
Manisha ji, I am participating in your program, and I will like to definitely say that yes, despite having perhaps pursued unheard track record in competing difficult projects, I think we have not been able to satisfy our valued customers, the homeowners. And I am conscious, my team is conscious, and I am feel sorry that they have been put to this undue tension, but they should take only they should be confident that fully I am conscious and my team is conscious, and we also have taken a call that this Formula One last year, this year, because expressway, they are all work in progress in last 3 years, and they are very at hectic pace.
Yes.
And lot of time went in some external matters also into this project.
I said that. I mean, it working in the real estate so sector is full of challenges.
But I must say, through your channel, that every member is committed, and you will find lot of good vibes coming on this front on delivery of these homes after October. You will find yourself, and I'm and you're very conscious, and I apologize to the people who have been put to difficulty.
A very candid Manoj Kaur there, apologetic about the delays on the real estate projects from the group. And I think what really bothers him is the fact that the group has been able to do so much when it comes to mega power projects, cement projects, infra projects, but they haven't been able to get the traction on their real estate business. Or is it because it's a consumer facing business, Sameer, and that's the reason why the backlash is so much bigger?
Partially correct. Also, they had very ambitious plans in real estate as well. They've gone about selling 31,000 units in Noida alone, which is much more than any developer has done in Noida or any part of the country.
So the
over
sheer
the last
numbers
few years, the sheer numbers,
so
the sheer
more.
Volume is so high, and it is partially a consumer-facing business, and it is a new business for them. This is not their expertise. They just owned a large land bank, and they've gone about developing it. But I think they will do a fantastic job. I think they have all the experience behind them. Yes, execution delays, they're not the only developer who done that. It is across the board that has happened. Developers who also just gone and executed 200 to 5,000 units over the last 2 years have had severe execution delays.
So 31,000 is a big chunk.
It's a big chunk. The good part is that I believe that they will deliver all the units.
They will deliver.
They will get
at least
delayed,
that faith
that
you
that
have
faith
in the group that you will get delivery.
Because of their capability and domain expertise in infrastructure development. So I think that will get translated into real estate. And after all, real estate construction is also an infrastructure kind of play.
And Manoj Kaur saying that 2 crore whatever, so that translates to 20 million square feet of land going to be developed more now.
Absolutely.
So what, how is
the
that going to
big
change?
Concern is, yes, the only big concern is that the demand supply mismatch is huge with respect to Noida and Greater Noida. Greater Noida has not seen any price appreciation because of lack of employment generation over there, although all the infrastructure has been there. Noida is going to see 100,000 units on the expressway alone. So I think because of so much supply and additional supply coming on the Yamuna Expressway, this is going to be a 5 to 10 year story. It's not going to be a short term story for people with respect to they're looking at appreciation.
But definitely it's going to give you a lot many more affordable housing options.
That's
around in NCR.
Already happened. Thanks to I think JP and many other developers over there, you had Noida Expressway at 7 to 8,000 rupees a square feet and going higher. And today you get projects over there 3 to 4,000 rupees a square feet thanks to so much land getting released, and affordability has happened through this kind of supply.
All right, Sameer, thanks very much for that perspective. So here's a total perspective on what Yamuna Expressway does. Yes, it cuts down your travel time from NCR to Agra, but more importantly, a lot of land parcel will get opened up, a lot of affordable housing will come up, especially in the NCR. If you look at rates in Delhi, Gurgaon, vis-a-vis what will happen in Noida, Greater Noida and Expressway, but don't expect appreciation in a hurry. Thanks very much. We are ending the realty debate on a very interesting note with a very special interview. I hope you enjoyed it as much as we did. Goodbye.